least also. To such an extent that nobody would believe in Santa Claus draped in blue. I think this is the rival soft drink company of Coca-Cola. Pepsi, I think they have started a campaign and started to paint Santa Claus in blue. It failed, right?
In because Coca-Cola, I suppose the cap of the bottle is red.
Red
is more dominant in that.
Yes. Yeah.
I think Pepsi blue is more dominant.
Blue is more dominant. So that is why, you know, they linked it with the figure of Santa Claus to begin with. So this idea that it is for revelry, for fun, among the children, the young people. So this image became so important, the image created by the media. The Valentine's Day, and people of my generation don't have any memory of Valentine's Day when we were kids, unfortunately, right? Then fairness came for boys. It has also started, I think, about 20 years back. Prior to that, when I was growing up, people used to laugh at girls' fairness claims. Okay. Then single stick in China. How many of you know about it?
Single
stick, what is it? Okay. So, yes, it's a celebration for the bachelors. See, in today's world, more and more people, particularly in the developed world, you know, where financial situation and assurance is much higher in comparison to the Indian society, more and more girls and boys are opting for remaining single. But then, you know, they also have a desire to participate in this fanfare of wedding, you know, those dresses, those things, etc. So then there's a single day celebration in China. A particular day has been isolated by the media where everything is booked, you know. You can book a bride, you can book a groom, you can have guests, you can have a cake, you know. Whatever, you know, fancies you have about a wedding, it is officially permitted on that day. So gradually you will find that the days are not far off and Singles Day would be a reality for almost every country. So this is the impact of, you know, the media. So when we look at the media now, we find that the range is becoming vast. This printing press, electricity, chain line production on literature, media, entertainment, social life, public entertainment, and everything is linked, you know, with everything else in today's world. So we find when we talk about media, we talk about exploitation, the issues of genders are also parallel. So the technology has helped us in changing our perception of how a philosophical attitude can be materialized. So technology gives us tools to perceive the significance of Marxist ideology in new attempts. So, you talked about the UK, how it has developed. In USA, we find that the cultural studies had assumed a fairly empiricist form, you know, like audience surveys, etc. And they were more linked to the departments of anthropology and communication studies. In UK, as we have already seen it, you know, it's an interdisciplinary intellectual talent of sociology, Marxist, political theory, structure, semiotics, etc. And we do have people in the Birmingham University, Stuart Hall and others, who have started perceiving it. And primarily the focus of the Marxist philosophy, the media philosophy, etc., concentrated mainly in UK. So they wanted to analyze such things as the media police economic crisis by portraying the world in a way favorable to those in power, and how working class youth resisted their assigned social roles through rituals of dress, dance and music that offered a counterpoint to the work routines of modern culture, modern economic life. And they also talked about the resistance quality of punk and hippies, etc. Remember that when we have talked about Raymond Williams and others, when they said that the same clashes had also ingrained, had also an ingrained quality of resistance. And they have talked about it, that how every crisis is portrayed in such a manner that it is somehow favorable with the dominant class. A very interesting example is the portrayal of the Iraq crisis, I think about 10 years back, right? And what was the US role in it? And how was it portrayed by most of the media, the dominant media? It was portrayed in a way which was favorable to those who worried power, right? So you would find that everything, you know, it may be devastating to a whole country, but they portray it in such a manner that it is always shown in a favorable light to those people who are in power, in a dominant situation in that situation. And then the working class youth does not have much to protest on the basis of whatever they feel they have. So they also fall back on certain cultural aspects. The punk, the hippies, their songs, the alternate culture, you know, which thrives against the populist elite culture. So these cultural norms have also become a protest, a way of protest within culture and media. So gradually we find that Marxists have started to talk about the dominant culture, ideology like that. And then, you know, in UK by 1970s, it was established that the dominant culture can also be countered, resisted against using another parallel cultural motives, right? So it can be, now it's the same continuation in space. So TV and print media, advertising and popular literature magazines, they do have their representational quotes. And then the audience, you know, take away meanings which they want to take. Of course, often it is the structured meaning, message which is conveyed to them, but at the same time they can also decode cultural messages which allow them to think resistantly about their lives. I can cite you the example of Ekta Kapoor series. I don't know whether even now they are fashionable or not, but I remember that when my daughters were growing up, you know, Ekta Kapoor series were there on the prime time, and then I had to lure them away of it because I didn't want them to watch it. So very recently, you know, I think yesterday only I was looking at a particular advertisement where a girl is married to a young boy, right? It's still the advertisement, right? So what type of messages does it portray? It can portray these two messages simultaneously. The majority would be influenced positively because that is what the narrative of the program is likely to be. At the same time, some people may resist against that, think that it is oppressional. So within that, the chances and probabilities are there. So culture, I mean, let us escape it. There's one point which I want to make towards the end. Next one. Keep this one. Okay. Now, so the culture, this idea of world culture can be addressed in two incommensurable perspectives simultaneously. We can have a look at them as instruments of domination, economic domination, gender-based domination, ethnicity and race-related domination, right? And at the same time, we can also have a look at culture from the bottom up. So Marxist media criticism continues in both ways. They start looking at the media as an instrument of domination, but at the same time, after the cultural materialistic understanding of Marxist ideas, was started by Raymond Williams, they also started to look at as something which is bottom-up aspect, you know, how it can also be used as a resistance. The next part of my discussion was based on the electronic media, but I think we do not have time for that. So then we find that if we look at them as instruments of domination, what exactly are the factors that the Marxist philosophy is taking into consideration? Media is owned by large corporates, firstly, and therefore they want to protect the interest of the economic and the rich class. Second factor is that they are largely run by men. So they decide what women have to view. So it is their prerogatives. And entertainment industry in general cannot help but assist the reproduction of the social system which is in existence today. Capitalism, new colonialism, and the patriarchy. In India, you look at the TV series which by and large support the narrative of patriarchy. So you will find that these narratives are controlled by media and therefore they are also a means of domination. Because they want to teach women that patriarchy is a value. They want to teach men that patriarchy has to be continued because it is in the interest of everybody. It's a great sector. Secondly, they also have this capacity to be accessed by a very large audience so that there is no way to filter the message, you know, once it is out, so it is out, you know, people would access it by any means. And then, you know, once people have started having this access, they would have firstly European impulses and obliquely limiting cultural options. So European impulses is something which we can understand very easily. For example, all those novels by Mason Coons, which were popular when I was a child, and I think that now they must have been replaced by some similar type of brand name, perhaps, you know. So then those, you know, what's those, you know, fairy stories, fairy tales, the famous fairy tales, you know. And now we would find that the young children can look at the comics, you know, which are so beautifully crafted. And then there is a parallel narrative also. Recently I saw a cartoon movie, Brave. I don't know how many of you have seen it, you know, which is based on a girl, you know, who wants to be brave, etc. So anyway, so it's the European impulses which, you know, allows us to create a glass palace in the inside of our mind to take refuge after the days of hard labor. Then also they also present limiting cultural options, right? What is the option? If you don't want to see that serial when a girl is married to a young child, then what are the other options? Similar type of movie, maybe going on in another channel. So the idea is that the cultural experiences are made very limited, so to create a particular type of mindset among the people. And that is why Marx had said that they help us in mitigating the use of police force, because you would automatically know a generation which has been, you know, which has grown on a certain serial would think that the domestic violence is the norm. It's not an exception, right? So when a woman thinks that this violence is the norm, she would perhaps not protest against it very easily. So you would find that the force is not required. The mindset has been changed permanently. Incidentally, D.H. Lawrence, another early 20th century novelist, was the first one to point it out. In one of his articles, he had said that in today's world, and that is before the First World War that we are beginning, a 16-year-old girl knows what it is to fall in love, even without actually having fallen in love. She knows what are the phrases she has to use. She knows how she has to dress up, what type of body language she has to manage. So there is no spontaneity in the reaction of this girl when she falls in love for the first time. Everything has already been answered by the contemporary media. So you would find that this is what you mean by having limiting cultural options with us. So we pour this aspect is bottom up now. Earlier it was the topmost, top to bottom, now it is bottom to top. So this pays more attention to the way such forms as music, particularly the punk, the Beatles, etc., express energies and attitudes which are fundamentally at odds with the attitudes and assumptions of the capitalist or patriarchal, or let us say any dominant social order. They also allow us a deferment of gratification in order to be better able to work, right? So they provide us a deferment, a way out, the Beatles, music, etc. But ultimately, they also allow us to continue our work within a social system. And that is why media is such an effective tool. And it was Karl Marx who had understood it for the first time. So they think that culture comes from below, right? This bottom-up approach. It can be harnessed in profitable and ultimately socially conservative ways, as I was saying just now. It also represents the permanent possibility of eruption, which is of dissonance and of an alternative imagination of reality. Let us stop here, because the next part is absolutely dependent on how the electric media has incorporated changes in these perceptions. So what we have covered basically is how Marxists originally viewed them, how in the beginning of the 20th century, between 1950s and 70s, these situations changed, and at the same time, we find that the print media age had a particular understanding of the Marxist theories. In my next part, I had tried to trace how the electric media, like not the mechanical media, but the electric media. has tried to incorporate certain other changes, and what do we mean by the Marxist ideologies in today's world of social media particularly. Okay, so any questions, suggestions, you can talk to me. Marxism is very interesting, you know, you can close it.